want to talk to you today about the problem of human sickness and human affliction and suffering. I want to answer the question for you today from the New Testament. Where does sickness come from? Where does sickness come from? I'm going to begin right here in Acts chapter 10. I'm going to read for you, if I may, Acts chapter 10, verse 38. If you have your Bible there, you can open with me. Acts 10, 38. We're going to answer the question today, where does sickness come from? The Bible says in Acts 10, 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. And he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. I'm going to read that to you again. It's important. Amen. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I want you to hear that again. Read that with me, if you would. The Bible says that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, and he went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. You need to know that verse of scripture. If you're sick today and you're wondering if maybe God's using that sickness to punish you or to teach you something, amen? The Bible makes it clear that God's not the punisher, that God's not the damner, that God is the blessed, that he anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, and Jesus went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. You see, the Bible makes it clear that all healing is of God and all oppression is of the devil. Jesus Christ went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. You see, all oppression, the Bible reveals, comes from Satan, never comes from God. The Bible says, as a matter of fact, let me just read to you James chapter 1, verse 17. I could quote it for you probably, but I want to get it right. Every good and perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. You know, the Bible says only good things come from God. Evil things, sickness, disease, poverty, death, confusion, frustration, failure, divorce, sin. These things don't come from God. The Bible says that only good and perfect things come down from God, the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. That means if it's good, it's God. If it's bad, it's the devil. And that means also it'll never change. With God, there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. God's never going to change. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If sickness didn't come from God when Jesus walked on the earth, it doesn't come from God today. If Jesus healed sickness, physical affliction and sickness I'm referring to now, not just spiritual affliction and sickness, I'm telling you today, Jesus was a physical healer while he was on the earth, and Jesus is still a physical healer today, even though he's been ascended. He has ascended to be seated at the Father's right hand. Hebrews 13:8 says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Malachi chapter 3, I believe, verse 6, I'll get you in the neighborhood. You'll have to check the address yourself. I believe it's Malachi 3:6, where God has decreed of himself, "For I am God, I change not." And James said of the Father, only good and perfect gifts come down from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Folks, the Bible's clear. Sickness doesn't come from God. Sickness is not good. Killing, stealing, and destroying comes from the devil. John 10:10, Jesus said, and this is the greatest revelation in all of Scripture. John 10:10, Jesus said, "The thief cometh not, but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I have come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly." Jesus said if it's killing, stealing, or destroying, that's what sickness does, you know, it's slow death. It's just killing you slow. Killing, it's stealing your health, and it's destroying your life. He said it's from the devil. He said, "I, on the other hand, have come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly." And James, the half-brother of Jesus, he grew up in Jesus' house. And if he learned anything from Jesus, he learned this in James 1:17. James 1:17, let me just go back and read it to you again. Every good and perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. If it's good, it's God. If it's bad, it's the devil. Only good and perfect gifts come from God. Sickness is not a good and perfect gift. Killing, stealing, and destroying, those aren't good and perfect gifts, folks. People, precious people, listen, Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. You know, there was never a smidgen, if I may, of sickness and disease in the earth until Adam and Eve sinned. You know, Adam and Eve never spent a sick day in their life until they disobeyed God and they partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, contrary to what Father God told them that they could not do. And God told them ahead of time. He said, if you partake of that tree, he said, there's just one, you can, everything in the world is yours. You can do anything that you want. Nothing is sinful to you. Nothing is above you. Nothing is beyond you. He said, you can do anything that you want in this earth. I appoint you as the precious keepers of my created earth, and you can do anything you want except for partaking of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He said, the day that you partake of that, you'll die, spiritually speaking. We know that he wasn't just talking about physically, because the Bible reveals in the book of Genesis that Adam and Eve didn't physically die for 930 years after they disobeyed God. He was talking about spiritually, dying spiritually. He said, in the day that you disobey me and partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you'll become separated from me, you'll cease to be like me, and every imaginable curse will come upon you. And that's when Adam and Eve begin to experience a sickness and disease, a separation from God, poverty, every imaginable curse. I want you to understand today, Adam and Eve were never sick a day in their lives until they disobeyed God. And God didn't send sickness into the earth. Adam and Eve allowed sickness to come into the earth by obeying Satan. There was no sickness in the earth until Adam and Eve, the keepers of the garden, the keepers of this precious created earth, until they obeyed Satan, bowed their knee to him, ceased to be like God, and became like him. And killing, stealing, and destroying overtook them. There was never a smidgen of sickness in this earth until Adam and Eve disobeyed God and they allowed it to come into the earth. God didn't cause it to come into the earth. God allowed it to come into the earth only because Adam and Eve allowed it to come into the earth. He made them the keepers of the garden. He gave them complete autonomy, complete authority over the earth. And Satan came and tempted them to sin and to disobey God. And when they did, a curse came upon their lives. And one of the things that curse brought is sickness. Listen, God didn't do it. God permitted it. God allowed it because Adam and Eve permitted it. And Adam and Eve allowed it. They are the ones in authority. They were the ones who were in authority. Amen. This is why Jesus had to come. God, when Adam and Eve gave the earth over to Satan, God didn't have the right to take it back from Satan. It wasn't his to take back. He gave it to Adam. He gave it to Eve. Listen, a man gave it to Satan. Only a man could take it back. God didn't have the authority. He didn't have the right to come and take the earth back from Satan. Once Adam and Eve gave it to Satan, a man gave it away. Only a man could take it back. And that's why Jesus had to come. That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, he made him who knew no sin to be made sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. You see, Jesus' work at Calvary far outweighs Satan's work in the garden. I said Jesus' work at Calvary far outweighs Satan's work in the garden. Adam gave authority to the earth, to Satan as a man. A man gave it away. Only a man could take it back. Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, came as a man, took that authority back from Satan that he deceitfully stole from Adam. And now he gives authority of the earth back to you and back to me. That's what the Bible reveals. That's what the Bible reveals. See, God's not the one in authority in this earth. We are the ones who are in authority in this earth. God gave the earth to us. It's ours. We are now the keepers of the garden. And if sickness has come into your body today, really there's nothing that God can do about it. If you don't do something about it, you're going to have to use your faith, your authority, your dignity, and your restored dominion, which was purchased for you through the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to have to use His delegated authority and do something now to get that sickness off of you. See, God's done everything that He's going to do about physical sickness and poverty and affliction and the curse of the law of sin and death in this earth. Now it's up to us to do something with the authority that Jesus delegated to us when He came and took it from Satan. That's why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, He said, "All power and all authority is given unto me. Therefore, go ye into the nations of the world and teach and preach and baptize." When He said all power and authority is given unto me after coming up out of spending 3 days in the bowels of hell, when He said to His disciples, "Let it be you and let it be me," when He said all power and authority is given unto me, therefore go ye, see, He was delegating His power and His authority to us. And then He went back to heaven. That's what He meant when He said in John 14, 12, He said, the works that I do, you will do as well. Only greater works you will do because I go to be with the Father. He was referring to going back to being seated to His position of authority, at the Father's right hand, and sending the Holy Spirit back to indwell us so that we could do the same works that He did through the agency of the Holy Spirit. You see, Matthew chapter 4 reveals that everything that Jesus did, He did not as a man and not as God, although He was man, fully man and fully God. Everything that He did as a man, baptized with the Holy Spirit. You find that in Matthew chapter 4, in Philippians chapter 2. Study it out. Everything Jesus did in this earth, every miracle He performed, He did not perform solely as the Son of God, simply only as the Son of God. He did it as a man. 100% human being, 100% God, yes, but everything that He did, every miracle He performed as a man who was baptized with the Holy Spirit. It was the Holy Spirit performing those works through Him. As a matter of fact, Jesus even said Himself in John 14, 10, He said, "The Father within me," through the agency of the Holy Spirit, I'm paraphrasing, "the Father within me," through the agency of the Holy Spirit, He performs the mighty signs, wonders, and miracles. Jesus said, "I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but to do the will of Him who sent me." Every time Jesus healed the sick, He revealed the will of God. You see, Jesus Christ was the will of God in action while He was here on this earth. When you follow the ministry of Jesus and you see all the signs and wonders and miracles and mighty acts of mercy and compassion in the New Testament, you see the will of God in action. Jesus said again, John 6:38, He said, "I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but to do the will of Him who sent me." Jesus never defied His Father when He healed the sick. He was always performing the will of God when He healed the sick. It is never God's will for people to be sick. Never, never, never. Let me just read to you some verses of Scripture. Let me turn over here, look at the ministry of Jesus, because if we want to see what God is like, we must absolutely look at the ministry of Jesus. Let's begin over here in Matthew chapter 8 in verse 1. We want to look at the ministry of Jesus if we want to see how the Father feels about physical affliction, physical suffering, amen. Now, I know a lot of folks don't agree with this, amen, but that's because a lot of folks aren't building on the Word of God. Jesus said, "In the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word will be established." We endeavor to give you two or three confirming verses of Scripture for everything that we teach you, amen. You will not find two or three confirming verses of Scripture anywhere in the Bible that teach that God is the author of sickness, but you will find a multitude of examples throughout the Old and New Testament that reveal that Satan is the author of sickness and disease, and that God is the author of healing and blessing. Amen. Listen, God is never your problem. God is always your solution. If you're sick today, God's not causing you to be sick. God wants to heal you. Amen. Maybe you may have opened the door somewhere through sin in your life. You may have opened the door to physical sickness in your life, and you did that, not God. God had to permit it because you permitted it, just like God had to permit it in the garden when Adam and Eve permitted it in the garden. Amen. But God's not doing it to you. God's not trying to get glory out of you being sick. God never got glory out of anybody being sick in the Bible. God's not getting any glory out of you being sick and laying flat on your back and not able to go out and be a blessing to the world right now. God's not making you sick. You opened the door to sickness, and God had to permit it because you've permitted it somewhere in your life. And you'll know where that is. You know where you're in sin. You know where you've left the door open to the devil. And all you have to do is ask the Father to forgive you. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to cleanse us from our sins and to forgive us of our sins, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Listen, God doesn't teach with sickness. God doesn't teach with disease. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 3:16, and I know that I told you I was going to read Matthew 8. I haven't forgotten. We'll get back over there. The Holy Spirit's leading me in this direction right now. 2 Timothy 3:16 says that the Word of God, not sickness, not disease, the Word of God is profitable for rebuke, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. The Bible does not say that God uses sickness to rebuke and to reprove and to correct and instruct in righteousness. The Bible says that God uses the Bible. He's a good Father. He's a good God. He's the Father of mercies, and He's the God of all comfort. If He's going to teach you something, He's going to teach you through the Bible and through men and women such as myself and this broadcast you're watching on television or listening by radio. He's teaching you right now, and He's telling you He's not the author of sickness. Jesus said the thief came to steal, to kill, and to destroy, but I have come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. God's not made you sick. Satan's made you sick. All you need to do is ask God to show you where you've opened the door to physical affliction and repent of whatever He shows to you, and you can be healed. The healing power of God will flow right into your body. You know, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 7 that wisdom is the principal thing with all you're getting. Get wisdom and get understanding. A lot of times people are praying for healing. Oh God, heal me. Oh God, heal me. And they're not getting healed because what they need to do is ask for wisdom. Ask for wisdom. Show me, Father, where have I opened the door? What am I doing wrong that has opened the door to the devil in my physical body? And I'll repent, I'll fix it, and God will heal you. Amen? God's not the author of sickness. Satan is the author of sickness. My opening scripture, the scripture we opened with, our text scripture in Acts 10:38, says how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, and He went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Sickness and oppression is of the devil, the Bible reveals. Healing is of God. You know, some people actually point their fingers and wag their tongues and shake their heads at folks like me who preach and teach divine healing. They say things like, people who teach divine healing are of the devil. Imagine Christians saying that about other Christians. But it happens nonetheless. They say divine healing is of Satan. God uses sickness to teach. Divine healing is of Satan, and God uses sickness to teach. That causes me to scratch my head every time I hear that. Do you realize if you believe that divine healing comes from Satan and that sickness comes from God, that you actually believe that Satan is more merciful than God? I said if you believe that divine healing is of the devil and sickness is of God, you actually believe that Satan is more merciful than God. Listen, you don't believe that today. You don't believe that Satan's more merciful than God. Listen, your brain is the same size as mine, and it should work just as proficiently. Amen? That doesn't even make sense, that Satan would be more merciful than God. Here in Matthew chapter 8, I told you we'd get back over here. I didn't lose my place. Amen? I wasn't running a rabbit trail. I'm speaking to hearts. Today the Holy Spirit knows who He's talking to, and He knows what they need to hear. And I like to just follow His lead and make sure that I'm letting Him do the talking and I'm not just overriding Him. Amen? God's talking to some of you today. Some of you precious born-again believers, you've been believing that God's been making you sick to teach you something, and that is not scriptural. You won't find that in the Bible. Not once in all of Scripture will you find God being glorified by sickness. In the ministry of Jesus, you'll find no less than 6 or 8 times where He healed sick, suffering human beings, and crowds and individuals broke out into praise, giving glory to God. Listen, sickness does not glorify God. healing glorifies God. Matthew chapter 8, I haven't forgotten where we are. Matthew 8, 1 through 3, when Jesus came down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, or if it is your will, thou can make me clean. Jesus, if it's your will, I know you can heal me. Jesus put forth his hand, even as I put forth my hand towards you, and released the healing virtue of Jesus into your life. In Jesus' strong name, Jesus put forth his hand and touched the leper, saying, I will, or it is my will, be thou cleansed. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Jesus said, I will. The leper said, if it's your will, I know you can. Jesus says, it is my will. Listen, Jesus said, I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but to do the will of him who sent me. Jesus healed that man, but before he healed him, he said, it is my will because it is my Father's will. This is the only time in all of Scripture where anyone ever approached Jesus asking for healing by saying, Jesus, if it is your will, I know you can heal me. And you realize what Jesus did here? He corrected him. He corrected the man for praying that way. He said, it is my will. You don't have to pray that way when it comes to divine healing. It is my will. Now be cleansed. And the man was supernaturally healed and made whole. Listen, Jesus didn't tell this leper here, well, now, son, God moves in mysterious ways, his wonders to behold. You know, God's ways are past finding out, and you know, God brought this leprosy to you to teach you something. Jesus didn't make ridiculous statements like that. Jesus never made ridiculous statements like that. Those statements are made by people who want to appear to be spiritual when they're not spiritual and they don't know what God's will is. Jesus did not say that to the leper. He said, I will, or it is my Father's will. And he stretched forth his hand and he healed that man immediately. Amen. We're very limited for time. Here Jesus over here in Luke chapter 13. I don't have time. I was going to read verses 11 through 17 to you. Let me just tell you real quick what's going on here. Jesus came across a woman who had a spirit of infirmity. For 18 years she was bowed over and she couldn't stand up straight. And when Jesus saw her, he laid his hands on her and he said, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And immediately she was healed. Well, the religious hypocrites were hacked off that Jesus did that on a holy day, on the Sabbath day. And Jesus turned to those religious hypocrites and he said, you bunch of hypocrites, you turn your own horses or your own asses and your own donkey loose from the stall for watering on the Sabbath, but you don't want a human being healed on the Sabbath. Jesus said, ought not this woman being a daughter of Abraham. Look in verse 16, it says, whom Satan hath bound. Ought not this woman being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan hath bound, be free? Be free on the Sabbath day? And when he had said these things, his adversaries were ashamed, and all the people rejoiced for the glorious things that were done. Here again, an example of healing glorifying God, not sickness. And here again, another example of Jesus saying, Satan bound this woman, not God. Listen, Jesus never healed anyone going against his Father's will. Jesus never healed anyone contrary or crosswise of his Father's will. He knew the Father's will and he performed it immediately. He knew that sickness is never the will of God. Listen, it's just not possible for me to accept the teaching that sickness comes from God as I follow the ministry of Jesus. Amen. The Bible says in Acts 10:38 that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. The Bible says in John 10:10, this is the greatest revelation in all of Scripture. John 10:10, Jesus said, the thief came to kill, to steal, and to destroy. I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Jesus said in John 6:38, he said, I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And then he healed every sick person that came to him for healing. Now, I understand some folks didn't get healed because some folks didn't meet the conditions. But whenever folks met the conditions of healing, always they were healed. Jesus never turned anybody away. Amen. Jesus said in John 14:10, he said, the Father within me, he do the miraculous mighty deeds of power. Amen. Listen, it's not possible to follow the ministry of Jesus through the New Testament and not know that it's always God's will to heal. Amen. He saw this woman who was bowed over for 18 years. Immediately he put his hands on her, set her free, and all the people glorified God. Amen. Listen, what do you believe today? Do you believe the Bible or do you believe tradition? The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I want to encourage you today from the precious, holy, written Word of God to know, to understand of a surety that God is never your problem. God is always your solution. Jesus said, all things are possible if only you believe. I'm going to release my faith for healing in your body right now. And if you can believe, you can receive. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the authority vested in me through the precious, holy, written Word of God, I command sickness to go from those within the sound of my voice. I bind the rulers of the darkness of this present evil world, demonic principalities and powers assigned against them, loose them and let them go. We saw from the Word of God today where sickness comes from. It doesn't come from God, it comes from Satan. We have authority over you, Satan. The Bible says if we resist you in James 4:7, that you will flee. The Bible says in Mark chapter 16 that we have complete authority over Satan and demon powers. Loose these people, let them go in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, I ask that your healing virtue now would come upon them within them, Father, and raise them up and make them whole in Jesus' strong name. If you can believe that, you can receive that. If you doubt that, you'll have to do without that. Amen. I encourage you, believe it today. Believe it today. Believe it and receive. The Bible says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who cometh unto God must not only believe that he exists, but that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. With that faith, receive, receive, receive the healing virtue of the Lord Jesus Christ. And always keep in mind, God is never your problem. God is always your solution. Be blessed in Jesus' strong name.